A tale of a woman born into scandal. An attractive and notorious femme fatale. Accused of crimes and carnal passions. But was she a murderess or a victim of the times? We now look at the provocative life of Lucrezia Borgia. And don't forget to subscribe and hit the bell icon, that way you'll never miss a new release. In a small town called Subiaco in Lazio on the 18th of April, 1480, Lucrezia Borgia was born. Her mother was Vanozza dei Cadenei, who was the mistress of Cardinal Rodrigo de Borgia, Lucrezia's father. As Lucrezia grew, her education would differ from other youngsters of the time. She would be guided by close relatives in which they encouraged her to learn quickly. This would, in what they hoped, create a bright and intelligent girl. She had a remarkable ability to learn foreign languages. As most young ladies of the day, she would be creative in respect of music and poetry being amongst her best abilities. However, they didn't have to worry too much. Lucrezia was an intelligent lady, and these traits would help her out in later life. Lucrezia was described as a lady with a beautiful complexion. It said she had hazel eyes that somehow changed color, and a walk that appeared as though she was drifting on the air. It would be these attributes that excited men, and this made her highly appreciated by the Italians during this period. In 1491, a marriage proposal was drawn up which would bring together Lucrezia and the Lord of Val d'Iora. But this plan was quickly annulled, and attention now turned to a more favorable contract, this time a man called Don Gaspar Aversa. Yet once again, this would go nowhere, and her father, Rodrigo, who became Pope Alexander VI, sought a more powerful coalition for his daughter, and one that would bring her into contact with known Italian dynasties. Now a new man would enter Lucrezia's life, Giovanni Sforza. He was a member of the House of Sforza and Lord of Pesaro. This time everyone seemed to agree to this match, and the couple married in Rome on the 12th of June 1493. Lucrezia's father was a man of need, and he along with the family never settled on second best and would always be on the lookout to turn their current interests into something even more substantial. It was now the Sforzas, at this point, were looked upon as irrelevant. Lucrezia's father, the Pope, required a more strategic approach to gain his political alliances. As for her husband, a version of the tale suggests he was to be executed, but Lucrezia warned him of the danger, and he fled Rome. A request to annul the marriage initially fell on deaf ears, as the Sforza family were extremely unhappy at the threats and the treatment they were now receiving. But the Pope wouldn't take no for an answer. He had said the couple had never consummated the marriage and that in his judgment was invalid. The Sforzas eventually gave in and signed confessions declaring impotence along with other documents to annul the marriage. Lucrezia was now free to marry again, and so discussions took place. She was this time to take the hand of Neapolitan Alfonso of Aragon. He was a half-brother of Sancho of Aragon, and she was the wife to Lucrezia's brother Geoffrey. But once again, the marriage was shorter than many expected and hoped for. The wedding took place in 1498, and now Lucrezia had the title of the Duchess Consort of Bachelier and Princess Consort of Salerno. But once again tragedy struck later. Alfonso had fled Rome through fear of retribution but then returned on his wife's pleas. Yet he would be murdered. Some say it was Lucrezia's brother Cesare who was behind the crime. The reasons for the murder were said to be due to Alfonso becoming close to France, in which he allied himself to their cause. Nevertheless, Alfonso was gone, and if there was one slight ray of happiness to come out of this marriage, it would be when they had a son, born in 1499, Rodrigo of Aragon. On the 31st of October 1501 was the scene of one of the most talked about parties to be held by the Borgia family. It was called the Banquet of Chestnuts and is considered one of the more extravagant get-togethers from the period. It was held in Cesare's quarters within the Palazzo Apostolico. And in attendance were 50 prostitutes, also known as courtesans. They were there as entertainment for the other guests. Johann Burchard was a priest and chronicler during the Italian Renaissance. He wrote an account of the event, although the accuracy of what he said is still disputed to this day.
After dinner, the candelabra with the burning candles were taken from the tables and placed on the floor, and chestnuts were strewn around, which the naked courtesans picked up, creeping on hands and knees between the chandeliers, while the Pope, Cesare, and his sister Lucrezia looked on. Finally, prizes were announced for those who could perform the act most often with the courtesans, such as tunics of silk, shoes, barrels, and other things.
Things were now back to square one for Lucrezia. She was not having a great deal of luck, but maybe this would change soon. It was once again her father, the Pope, had now arranged yet another marriage for her. In 1502 she got together with Alfonso I d'Este, Duke of Ferrara. It seems that this venture into matrimony may pay off. Together, the couple had 8 children, and at long last, Lucrezia was now considered a rising star. She was certainly accomplished and gaining an excellent reputation. But this would be on the back of her father's death and the fall of the Borgia family. However, as in all good stories, this marriage would have many twists and turns. It appears that both parties enjoyed partying. Neither of them would remain faithful, and affairs were commonplace. Lucrezia had flirted for an extended period with her brother-in-law, Francesco II of Gonzaga. Although he was also married and his wife Isabella d'Este was considered a cultured lady, and due to the nature of ongoing events would allow no friendship to blossom between herself and Lucrezia. The affair was said to be more salacious than one of sentiment. They both had a drive and passion that neither of them wanted to end. Yet, it would end, and as usual, in tears. In 1500, Francesco contracted syphilis, and the promiscuity stopped. A transmitted disease was certainly a no-go area for many, and due to this, it would be a further 2 years before the couple set eyes on each other again. But Lucrezia didn't waste any of that time. Francesco might be off the radar for now, but another man was looming. According to letters he wrote to her, Pietro Bembo, a poet, was said to have put pen to paper and conceived some of the most romantic and revealing scripts ever recorded. This notion was according to Lord Byron, an English peer and one of the leading figures of the Romantic movement. After first reading the letters at the Library of Milan on the 15th of October 1816, Lucrezia's affairs continued. She simply needed more than good poetry to quell her insatiable behavior. Next up was a co-commander of a French garrison based in Ferrara. Chevalier Bayard was seen to be a great admirer of Lucrezia. And the affair took place around 1510. It can be argued that the life of Lucrezia was unsettling, as she was pushed from pillar to post in her early years to gain her family some credence and power. Yet, as she grew, she seems to have fallen into many traps. It was her sexual appetite that quite possibly gave her an escape from the other world. Lucrezia had many children, yet she still suffered a long history of aborted pregnancies. However, on the 14th of June 1519, she gave birth to another child. A girl this time, and named Isabella Maria, who was named in honor of Alfonso's sister Isabella. But the delivery would have a disabling effect on both mother and child. Lucrezia had weakened significantly during the lead-up to her daughter's arrival, and the child was suffering too. Just 2 days later, after what seemed like Lucrezia was recovering slightly, she would once again fall, and her condition worsened. Lucrezia Borgia finally passed away on the 24th of June. She was just 39 years old. Her tomb can be found at the convent of Corpus Domini in Ferrara. Lucrezia has sometimes been called a femme fatale, alternatively a vamp or man-eater, which may be questionable, but what was the truth behind this family and its often perceived notoriety? These links to Lucrezia may possibly be seen as unfair criticism, but her reputation grew with stories of crime and debauchery. She was born to a family condemned as being corrupt and scheming. Her brother has been called a murderer, and rumors of incest are rife. But whatever aspect of Lucrezia's life you choose to believe, it comes across as a story you couldn't make up. But one thing is for certain: Lucrezia managed to bide her time. although when discussing her, an old figure of speech comes to mind, as in not being able to have your cake and eat it. However, it seems Lucrezia did, and by all accounts, it wasn't just the one cake. Thank you so much for watching, and don't forget to subscribe to History Roadshow, and why not check out one of these videos on your screen right now. We'll see you all again, very soon.